Alright, so it comes right here, but this is the blood transfusion system, or the otherwise known as the organ care system. Before an organ, you know how organs are, after transplant, before transplant, they're stored into a cooler and taken to whoever they need to. It doesn't last very long. This is supposed to solve that problem. What's mostly is this is a card where, say, a heart will be placed in this box, right? Instead of just freezing the box, the heart will actually be beating and functioning as it would in the human body. This machine here would actually be mimicking how the human body works, applying the organ with warm blood, full of oxygen, and mimicking the body heat and humidity that you find in regular human body. So while it's being transported, it's still functioning just as it was in the body. This keeps the organ healthier and more fresher, and has already been used at least 1815 times in successful operations. And that's about it. It's made by Transmedics, and it's relatively new.
So for my innovation article, I chose an article which addresses China becoming the world's most emerging and leading manufacturer and consumer of electric vehicles, due to the fact that many of their major cities, such as Beijing and Xi'an, are being polluted by industrial activities there. They're really pushing to create more alternative fuel vehicles, such as electric cars. The government is backing many automotive industries within the country in order to produce more electric cars. And they're seeing competition from outside companies such as Tesla, Ford, and Chevrolet, who offer much more sleek and luxurious designs rather than the Chinese designs, which are much more boxy and not as comfortable. So the Chinese market is struggling in order to push their automotive industry, and they're hoping that the emergence of new technologies in terms of making electrical cars more available and last longer will help drive the country towards eliminating internal combustion engines.
Okay, so the innovation that I chose to do my research on was Elon Musk's underground tunnel network. To give you some background information, Elon Reeve Musk is a Canadian-American. He was born in South Africa and he was always a businessman entrepreneur type. When he was 12, he released his first game and sold it for $500. Then he started up PayPal, which is a very known money exchange type of business. And he sold it to eBay for $1.5 billion and he received $165 million of that. And then with that money, in 2002, he started SpaceX, which is basically it pushes forward ideas so that we can have accessible space utilities. So they reuse rockets and then he also created in 2008 Tesla, which is a electric efficient car distribution type of company. But basically, his new innovation sprouted from when he was sitting in LA traffic, the infamous, crazy LA traffic. He was sitting there for hours and he was just like, this is so inefficient. We need something to fix this. So he outlined a way to network underground tunnels so he could transport through 30 different layers a way on an electric skate to go from place to place. Basically, the car just goes onto a platform that's transported down to one of the 30 levels and then is transported to the place that they would like from an electric skate, then is transported up back to the street, and it's just a more efficient way to just go from place to place, and it's the new future of transportation in my opinion. Thank you.
For my innovation, I chose to do the Google Pixel Buds. And they look like regular headphones, but they're actually pretty cool because what they can do is they have a function which allows them to translate over 40 languages in time. So you could be talking to someone, they could be talking to you in French, and the headphones would get that and translate it to English. They come in three colors, which is not a lot, but it's black, blue, and gray. And they come in this small little pouch to keep them so you could take them anywhere. And they're also kind of wireless, although they have a little string that connects them from ear to ear so they don't fall off. They can also allow you to do everyday things without the use of your phone. They can set up meetings for you. They can read your emails to you. They can set up appointments and all that. The price is kind of steep, but like which is $159. But like for all they can do, I think it's pretty cool. So yeah.
So I'm going to present the technological innovation of the West Harvard Institute organ on a chip. So basically what these organs and chips do is a problem doctors and chemists were having is that to see how to deal with tumors and the kind of diseases, they had to use animals because they couldn't go inside a body and see how the tumor was how the tumor was occurring. So you have to use animals, and animals are not very good. Animal testing is very expensive and very inaccurate since it's not in the human body. So they made these chips to replace organs and see how the tumors would develop. So these chips are basically in vitro microenvironments. In vitro, what means is in a test tube or somewhere where you can see it. In vitro microenvironments, which represent body organs so that you can see more or less how it works. So they made chips for the brain, for the lungs, for the kidney, and these are more or less how they look. And they would inject the tumor and see how it develops throughout and see what cures they can get.
All right, today I'm going to be talking about the Falcon 9 rocket. It was created by SpaceX, and it's a two-stage rocket, and its goal is for reusable. To reuse the whole rocket to be able to make trips to right now the space station, and eventually their goal is to make it to the moon and Mars. So the Falcon 9 has proven that reusability is plausible in rocket engineering, I guess you can say that, and it's very affordable since you're reusing the rocket. The price can go down to as much as an airline ticket. So imagine going to Moon or Mars for about $100 to $200. I mean, it's a pretty crazy idea. The Falcon 9 has 9 Merlin engines, and they did that so it's kind of like this. This is the setup. So up to 2 and sometimes even 3 engines can fail, and it can land safely wherever. The Falcon 9 has an aluminum lithium alloy tank, but that's not really that important. And this is another model, which is called the Falcon Heavy. It can lift up to 150,000 pounds for heavier orbits, or heavier satellites. The Falcon 9 can lift up to 50,000 pounds, which is an armored carrier tank. And sometimes they land on a sea drone. There's 2 different names, which is, of course, I Still Love You and Just Read the Instructions, which is a play on words. They land automatically in the sea. There's a video that shows it towards the end, which is pretty interesting. Just here. That's it.
So my article was on AI, specifically on how it's not exactly what we want it to be. So the article was by Will Knight, and he's an MIT review articleist. He reviews technology and explains how it works, and how it's kind of a problem, and how it's successful, and how it helps. So his article is about how AI, which stands for artificial intelligence, we should all have encountered it since we all are very well aware of technology. So Siri, Alexa, Google, those are all forms of AI. So he explains how AI is super successful, how it manages to somehow drive and diagnose schizophrenia. But the problem with that is that scientists have created but don't know how it's doing it. And that's quite concerning because it could lead to failures. So AI, it can do multiple things. Really? That's a minute? It can do multiple things. It can do deep patient, deep sleep, which are sort of new technology that they're working on. Point is that it's unreliable because they do not know how it works, and they're worried about that because it can cause failures.
Okay, so how many of you have Echo at home? So, okay. And just how many of you know about it? Okay. And what about Google Home? Google Home, no? Okay. So, as you already know, Echo or Alexa is made from Amazon. It's a smart speaker. And Google Home is another speaker, smart speaker made by Google. And now Microsoft is coming with a new one that's called Invoke. And it's ready to take a war on the other two. So what's new about this one? It's Microsoft collaborating with another company called Harman Kardon, and it's it's another company from Samsung. And the speaker has 360 degrees of the speakers, the sound. And it can use Skype, and you can use it to turn off lights and stuff. And it's almost $200, so I don't think it's gonna do anything. And yeah, questions.
So my article was entitled Rise of the Machine. So the picture I chose was a scene from the third Terminator movie, Rise of the Machine. And it was about the use of smart technology in our homes for like as wearable tech and in our cities, and how it can be a problem and how it may be making some people's lives better. And an example of a lot of smart technology is like the Amazon Echo or the Google Home, that are different speakers. You just have them in your house and you can just talk and activate them and ask them a question and they'll give you an answer. And how the problem is with those things is that they make your lives infinitely more convenient, but the way in which those programs work, like for example the Google Home device, like if you ask them, like say like, oh, I'm hungry for like a specific type of food, it's automatically connected to the Open Table program, which is it's an application and it's like a service for creating reservations. And so if you are using this device and it's automatically connecting you to another already put in program, then you're sort of you're not getting an organically produced result, you're getting what they want you to know. And that's why, and by they, not the machines, but the people who program the machines and the people in charge. And so that's why the smart technology can be problematic and the rise of machines.
Okay, so this is a neural bypass, and it's been designed so that paralyzed people can regain the ability to move. The way it works is this has neurons in it, and it connects the neurons in your brain, and it's implanted around the base of your skull, and it sends a signal to electrodes implanted in the injured part of your body, and tells them to move again using electricity to make the muscles contract. And so it's actually proven to work. It's not just theoretical, like a lot of the technology for it so far. So far it's worked on a few different humans and a monkey. For example, one guy, he can only move his head and his left shoulder. And so they implanted his brain and his right shoulder, and he was able to, with help, move his arm and drink something. And it's really got a lot of potential. Stuff like this is being used to help people be able to hear again. That's why there's all of those videos going around the internet about kids being able to hear for the first time. And they're thinking that they might also be able to use it to help people see by putting on both parts of the optic nerve. That's it.